Good afternoon, South Africa. Welcome to Afternoon Express. I'm Bonnie Booty. We've got a hot show lined up for you today with some fierce female guests. First up, we chat to Mauritian Latifs. You'll remember her from the hit group Jamali, and she's now working on a debut solo album, so we'll be chatting to her about that, and she'll be performing for us. And we have in the loft today Pitbull in Heels, Farrah Fortune, who's one of South Africa's hottest publicists. And Allan Committee has a new show called Laughing Matters, and in the kitchen, Clem and Danilo have a few laughing matters of their own.
Oh, well, yes, we do, South Africa. You're going to have to stay tuned to find out more about that. Welcome to the show. My name is Danilo Acquisto. And yes, there is still a chance for you to win with us in our Clicks Advent Calendar giveaways. So take out that phone right now. Get that number of ours on speed dial. And when you see that little Clicks Advent Calendar logo pop up on screen, give us a call immediately. The first person through to our floor will win themselves a spot prize, and they'll get a chance to win themselves a car, potentially, at the end of the competition. We're giving away a Chevy Spark on national television. We're like the Oprah of TV. Clem, what's up?
Wait, you never give me anything.
Oh, you don't ever get to win stuff because all your recipes you basically make for yourself and we pay for all the ingredients. So you might as well just like a gift, a free gift on the show every time you're on air, Clem. And here.
Okay. Merry Christmas.
Is that all I'm getting for Christmas? We'll talk to you in the ad break.
So what are you making on the show today?
So we're talking about Christmas, right? Mm-hmm. And the fact that there are always so many leftovers afterwards. Yeah. Today I'm going to share a couple of like tips and tricks on what to do with that.
I think everyone at home is like, wow, I'm so confused. What do you mean? My family eats everything and everything in the home during the sort of festive season. But if you are that family who's like, you know what, I'll just leave a portion of this aside, you know, then maybe that is your family. We'll be showing you what to do with all of those leftovers right here in Afternoon Express. Plus you're making something else a little bit later on,
yes.
Right?
So I'm going to be using some leftovers to prepare a beautiful snookfish cake. Ooh. That's been encrusted in coconut, served in a salad. Ooh. It's crunchy, it's fresh, it's light, it's delicious.
All that and more coming up later right here on Afternoon Express. Now our first guest is on the couch. Mauritian Latifs is here. She began her solo career with her first single, Let Me Live My Life, which blew up on radio stations across the country, and she is currently working on her debut solo album. But it all started back in the early noughties with the renowned pop group Jamali, which she was part of for a good 10 years.
What you call staying power. Joining us now is Mauritian Latifs, the gorgeous and talented
thank
one.
Thank you.
Welcome
gorgeous
to the
Bonnie. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So you started singing at the age of 11.
Yeah, you know, and unofficially. And then
unofficially.
Officially with Jamali when I was, what, about 20 years old?
Yeah. And before we get to your journey with Jamali, how did you have any inkling at that point when you were 11 years old that you would turn this into a career?
I think I've always known. I think when when you're destined for something, it's you keep working at it. And I think I've always known, you know, I'm going to be on stage. I didn't know how or when, but I made sure that it was going to happen for me, you know, at some stage in my life. And I was just a muso at heart, and I would have posters in my room of all my favorite artists, you know, like a vision board almost. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I'd play my favorite tracks and I would just like, you know, play it back. And that was almost like my my exercise, vocal exercises, because people were like, how do you sing like that? Do you have any, like, you know, did you have training? And I'm like, no, I just listen to my favorite artists, and, you know, you pick up the skill and little things from that.
Absolutely. Yeah. Now let's talk about a very important part of your journey, which was Jamali. Tell us
very
about
important.
That journey.
It was mind-blowing. I mean, what, 10 years? We were together for about 10 years. You don't mentally prepare yourself, you know, when you go into a group. You don't prepare yourself for what's going to happen afterwards.
Right.
In your mind, you're young, you just want to be on stage, you want to perform.
And it all started with a competition,
yes, it
really.
Started with Coca-Cola Pop Stars, and I think all of us, you know, we just wanted to be on stage and sing. And, you know, a lot went into it, you know, also when it comes to, you know, the PR side of things. And it's a whole bunch of things that, you know, that become more intricate later on. But I guess in the beginning for us, it was the platform was amazing. It was a dream, and we were just living the dream.
Yeah.
You know, we were these three girls. We were the runners-up. We did not win the competition.
Right, and a lot of people don't remember that because of your success that followed.
I suppose,
followed.
The underdogs, eh? But we kept working at it. I think when you're the underdog, it motivates you and it fuels you a bit more to want to prove yourself, you know?
Yeah.
And I think, yes, we were a manufactured band, but, in the end, I feel like we did prove ourselves,
you know,
as a successful group that can make it.
Yeah.
You know, we're not just manufactured in bubblegum, but...
Yeah. I mean, I definitely do think you're one of the longest-standing girl groups.
Yeah.
I mean,
we were
a 10-year journey.
Yeah.
What went into that? What do you think made you such a unique group?
I think
and what gave you that staying power
staying
and
power.
That cohesion?
I think it was, you know, the passion, the dedication also. And I think it was individually we just gelled. We all knew what we wanted, you know, and together when we put our brains together, we're like, okay, let's do this. Let's try and make this thing work, you know. And I think it's that just putting our heads together, and it was like-minded, you know, we were like-minded individuals and we wanted the same things at the time. Which made it work. We just gelled. It was a nice time, and we had a lot of fun together. So we actually enjoyed each other.
Yeah.
And I think when you enjoy each other, it's so organic. Everything else just becomes so natural. We perform on stage, and we want to do more of it. And musically, you know, we were very similar as well, you know, in terms of our backgrounds musically. So it was easy.
And where are the girls now? Are you guys still friends?
Yeah, we're still friends. I mean, they're doing their thing. Ever so often, we still do perform together when there's a booking. But I still see them. They're all doing their own thing, you know, albums. Jackie went into, I think, fashion as well, into her own label.
Yeah.
And Liesl also working on her music and performing, just doing their thing.
And then your solo career. How did that decision come about? And how did you know you were ready?
I can't really say it was a decision. I think it just happened really organically.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was 10 years. And, you know, with any group, if you're together for that long, at the end of the day, we are three individuals with, you know, different dreams and desires. And at some point, things do change. You know, we grow, we evolve, and we want different things.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
that's how it really started. You know, we all started wanting different things. And, you know, I mean, I'm a writer, songwriter as well, and I've got my own sound, and the Jamali sound wasn't necessarily my sound.
Right.
So, you know, when things started, like, you know, slowing down a little bit for us, we had a little bit of a meeting, and we were like, what do you guys think? Should we, you know, pursue this individual career thing? And they were like, why not? Why would we hold each other back from
Absolutely.
That, you know? We would never hold each other back from growing. And that's how it happened.
Yeah.
And it was, I mean, it was an interesting transition. You know, I've been solo, 3 years now? So it's been very interesting.
Now, the Mauritian brand versus the Jamali brand, how different is that? And how did you engineer that and get to a place where you are now?
You know, I think it starts with, first and foremost, because, I mean, Jamali had, you know, when we came into the scene, there was PR, we had a label, we had everything, you know, done for us.
Set up,
It was set up, it was done for you. And, you know, when I went into the, you know, my solo transition, the first thing that I had to look at, you know, was PR. It was one of the most important things, because at the end of the day, I was packaged for a group and I was clothed for a group. But people didn't really know who the individual Mauritian was. So if you know, if you say the name Mauritian, it's like, who's
right.
that?
Yeah.
You know, or they'll see you and they'll be like, oh, you look so familiar, but they can't place you. But when you're in the group, they knew who you were. So I think I started, for me, it was mainly the PR, because I needed someone to help me find my brand narrative. And that's when I went to, you know, African Star for that, approached them, and Farah kind of understood what I wanted.
Mm-hmm.
And it made it easier for me to focus on my craft, which is the music, and to refine that a bit more and find my sound.
Yeah.
Mauritian is, you know, she's a sensual singer, you know. I would like to think that I represent hope, you know, in my music.
Mm-hmm.
I love my songs to be, you know, fun and sexy, but also have a positive message at the same time, and not just something that's gonna, you know, booty hopping.
Yeah.
So
you're gonna perform for us in a little bit, and your single Go Low. Do you think that best paints your Mauritian's narrative?
I think
and why?
So. I think so. just, I think with this one, it was just more, I wanted to have fun with this. I'm this deep person and I'm always trying to like put words and things together. I'm like, I just want to have fun. I want to, you know, show a side of me that people have never seen. I want to reintroduce myself because that's essentially what I have to do. You know, I'm having fun with it. I'm reintroducing myself and I'm showing my sexy side.
Yeah. And globally, are there any strides you're making towards making Mauritia known
Definitely.
All over the world?
I mean, I think every artist, that's every artist's, you know, mission. And for me, it starts with the people that I collaborate with and the producers I work with. I work with Alexis Farku. He's well-traveled. He's been around the world.
Absolutely.
You know Alexis.
Yeah.
And I work with a Nigerian producer. He's one of the best in Nigeria called Gospel on the Beats. And he works with many prolific artists. And so I feel like it starts there for me. You have to go beyond your culture and you have to, like, you know, delve into that.
Get out of your
and
comfort
once
zone.
That, yeah, once your music is established, I think going abroad and selling your music and selling yourself and your brand becomes easier.
Well, we can't wait for your performance and we're going to chat
Thank
in a
so
little
much.
Bit about
Please.
The business side of it
Thank
more.
You.
Let's see what you have to say on social media with Danilo.
We'd love to have you guys send through all your comments on our Facebook page. You can find us online. It's Afternoon Express. There are a whole bunch of posts. Particularly, there's this one here that you can go and comment on, which is just the generalized post that we can read all your comments from. There's also a post up there that we've just posted now of Mauritia as well. So go and comment and send her as much love as you can. There's one here that says Twitch, who says, Marie is so beautiful. She still looks absolutely amazing. Can't wait for a performance a little bit later on. And then loads of you are asking for that number for how entering our competition on Afternoon Express today. That number 083-913-3728. And speaking of which, that little symbol has not popped up on screen just yet. So if you guys want to go and make sure that you stay tuned to Afternoon Express, you must definitely go and do that. And the minute that little symbol pops up on screen, give us a call immediately on that number. And then you can win yourself a spot prize. I see there only are three chances left to win of those spot prizes. That means three more people getting to win a chance to win a Chevy Spark with us on Afternoon Express. So make sure you guys stay tuned for that. It's going to be absolutely epic. And then also later on after the break, Clem and I are going to be showing you some really cool hacks of what to do with your Christmas leftovers and so much more still to come on Afternoon Express. Express yourself. Express yourself. Welcome back to Afternoon Express. So we're in my favorite place in the loft today and your favorite place as well. I'm going to almost said kitchen already and I just gave away my joke before the beginning. Welcome back to the show. It's good to have you. Today we are going to be talking a little bit more about those festive leftovers. There are always times where there's something a little bit left over that's not enough for one dish in its own right to have a meal on its own. And we're going to be showing you how to combine all of those things together to create something super delicious. Mm-hmm. I cannot wait to see what you've got planned because this is probably every family's nightmare except my family after the Christmas season.
Why is it a nightmare? I think we need to embrace leftovers. They're awesome.
No, but you know what I'm saying? You see it in the fridge, you're like, that's not enough for like a whole meal for like the three of us right now, so I can't really make that. So he leaves it there and then it goes dry and then eventually it's
so
just done.
You're going to eat,
Yeah, sorry. Dog biscuits for you, maybe?
All right. So let's get straight into it. So I'll just pop my pan on because I'm going to fry up a little egg and I'll explain why in a second.
Cool.
So one of the most like common problems for me in the world, leftover roast potatoes. What do you do with them?
Don't know if that's a thing, Clem.
It's such a serious problem. Mm. Like, next year, that's going to be my challenge.
Okay.
Let's solve this problem.
So
I got
everyone's
going to
have hashtag save the this and save the that. You're going to do hashtag save the roast leftover potato. Roasted
there
potato.
So I got one solution, okay? Mm-hmm. Let me choose my courses, okay?
Okay.
All right. So
Your course. Choose your course.
All right. So leftover roast potatoes.
Yes.
It's now Boxing Day. So you've got some roast meat mm-hmm. and some potatoes. All I did was simply chop them up. Mush them all together, and I created something called a hash.
Oh, like a hash brownie.
Yeah.
Yes.
So it's quite an American thing. It's kind of diner style. It's a combination of some potatoes and some meat of some sort. Normally, either brisket or corned beef.
Oh, I've never seen that.
And then they
done with meat inside.
Yeah. Mm. Pop it into a pan, and then cook it like a nice, think of like a nice brisket, like savory brisket.
Mm.
And you flip it like a pancake, and you pop it back in your plate. You got that beautiful crust. So you bring the roast potato back to life.
Okay. Tips on how to get that crust crispy outside, because particularly with leftover potatoes, they go cold and then they go like floury.
Or very waxy, depending on what potato you're using.
Okay.
So the trick is to kind of put it in the pan and mush everything down and leave it.
Just cook that way, the heck out of it.
Yeah, but not on a high heat, medium heat. And that way you get that crust and also steams through the potato on the inside so it becomes nice and fluffy again.
Okay, lovely. Cool. Bring it back to life.
So that's beautiful. All I did was added some roast beef to it, a little bit of spring onion and some parsley. Yummy. Mixed it all together, popped it in the pan and cooked it beautifully. So this is a breakfast dish. It's not breakfast unless it has an egg.
Man, this is a brilliant idea for that, the 26th or whatever. What do we call after New Year's? It's also called Boxing Day, or is
Boxing
that after
Day,
Christmas?
Yeah.
26th, I think, is Boxing Day. And then after New Year's as well, it's a really good idea. If you guys have gone out for a nice little lekker joel on a, on the first.
Exactly.
And you're like, I'm so hungry, but there's nothing left at home except leftovers. This is what you can make.
This is the ultimate dish for the morning after breakfast. Here we go. Yeah. So I will let the egg keep on cooking, and I'm going to go into the next thing. So you've been entertaining all holiday now, and every time a guest arrives, you pull out your little cheese platter and some breads. But the problem you end up with is, it's this.
Yeah, individually sliced crunch balls, basically rusks.
All right, but don't throw it away. You actually end up spending so much money when you do need to get breadcrumbs, go to the store, buying it.
Yeah.
When you've got it at home, it's real simple. You literally take your stale bread.
Oh my word, you're actually going to make breadcrumbs.
And the thing is, you can freeze it, and it'll last till next year's festive season.
Oh my gosh. You know what's really cool? My dad used to do this as well. I think it was my gran, I can't remember, but he used to do it with the birds. Used to take it outside and give it to little birds, and then have like a bird feast. Now you can eat it again.
That's right. And I promise you, you'll make it.
Oh my word, that is so cool.
And you can literally keep it in a freezer bag and it'll last until next year.
It felt like one of those things. I always see everyone, you know, when you buy like loaves of bread from like the grocery store, and at the bottom there's always a little bit of crumbs. And I was like, why am I spending so much money going to a store to go and buy these things called breadcrumbs when you can just somewhere do this and make your own?
So no one's ever allowed to buy breadcrumbs ever again.
Ever again.
Ever,
please.
Ever again.
Save the wheat.
Hashtag save the breadcrumbs.
Yes.
Hashtag
man.
Save the roast potatoes. Yes. Hashtag save the breadcrumbs.
Yes, Clem.
Cool.
Preach it.
So, okay, our fried eggs looking beautiful.
Yummy.
We just top that over there.
Oh, it's a nice, like, medium yolk.
It is. Breakfast done. Okay, next thing. So, herbs in the fridge. They don't actually, you know, the fridge is a dehydrator. Do you know that?
I do actually know that, but I've only experienced it. That's how I found out.
Yes. Yeah. So, it dries things out. And a lot of times, your herbs end up getting dried out really quickly.
They go black and they go like.
Yeah. So what I did was I just chopped them up. I popped them in an ice cube tray. All the herbs we had left over.
Oh, wow.
Okay. And I'm gonna take olive oil. And I'll just drizzle the olive oil in there, and I'm actually going to freeze it.
Wait, what the heck does that do?
Yes, it actually freezes.
No, but then what? Then what do you do with that?
So next time you're busy making a dish, you pop one of these olive oil cubes in your pan, it melts beautifully, and it's been flavored.
Lovely. And maybe what you can also do, if you don't have a herb like that, maybe you want to use something like mint. You just pour your mint in here, freeze it, then you can make a beautiful mojito, but with really nicely delicious flavored ice. Hey? I am really thinking smart.
You are.
Lemons as well. I'm sure you could do the lemons as well.
Getting carried away.
Okay.
Bring it back.
Let's come back to the
mint. So we're on the herb vibe. Let's talk about it. So you don't want to freeze it because you still want to use them fresh.
Mm-hmm.
As we said, the fridge actually dries things out. So Dan, there's a cool tip. Get one of these resealable fridge bags.
Mm-hmm.
Pop a piece of kitchen towel in there. And look at that from Willy, so you can just write what it is.
Oh, what it is on site. In case I forget.
For tomorrow.
The worst thing in the world would be get confused between... what's it?
Parsley and coriander.
Don't get confused between those two ever, people.
So there we go. So your herbs go in there. What happens is the tissue paper at the bottom ends up absorbing all the excess moisture.
And just keeps it locked in there.
And the seal stops the fridge from dehydrating your herbs. And they will last for twice as long.
These are probably the best hacks I've heard in a very, very long time. So Clem, thank you so much for sharing us the wisdom that is the Pedro...
I'm here all week. I'm just like... Applause. Come on, Dan.
I can hear everyone applauding. 3, 2, 1. I heard it. There we go. There was at least a couple of people that just applauded for those hacks right in Afternoon Express. Later on, we're going to be showing you how to use some leftovers as well to make a delicious dish. What are we making?
A beautiful coconut-crusted snook fish cake.
You're going to have to wait to find out more about that snook cake coming up a little bit later. Bonnie standing by on our couch with our next guest.
Fair Fortune is known as the pit bull in heels, and having built up a formidable reputation over the past decade as South Africa's hottest publicist, it's easy to understand how she's earned the title. She's handled celebrity clients from a range of industries, including AKA Casper Nyovest and Terry Peto. Plus, she's recently been listed in the top 50 most impactful social innovators. Welcome to the loft, Farah.
Thank you.
Lovely to have you with us.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. So you're not only known as the Pitbull in Heels on Twitter, I follow you on Twitter, but you're also a spicy relationship expert.
Spicy.
How's that come
about?
You're
going to bring that up with my mother sitting behind the cameras, aren't you? Life. I'm 37. Life teaches you stuff, hey?
Yeah, life will teach you stuff.
Life will show you things. So sometimes you just try and help other ladies not have to deal with all the things you had to deal with. You know, just trying to make a girl's life a little easier.
Yeah, absolutely. So you spent some of your childhood and some of your early adult life in different parts of Europe. How did that come about and how did that influence your choice in what you do now?
I was 10 when we left South Africa, and I think it was more my parents' decision. At the time, they wanted to give us better opportunities. You know, at the time we left, apartheid was very much in full swing, and it was very hard for us as coloured people to have a lot of opportunities at the time. And my parents wanted to give us as much as they could, and one of those was actually taking us out of the country. And having that kind of exposure to different cultures and so many other things, it makes you see the world very differently. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And then that was probably the greatest thing my parents could have ever done for us.
Yeah. Now, you've been in the PR industry for 8 years, but you say you started out with R1,000 in your pocket, a laptop and a cell phone in your room.
Yes.
How did you grow to build this empire?
Well, I've been in the PR industry longer than that, but I've had the company for 8 years. I tried to get a loan to start the business, and no one believed in the dream that I could see and hear, that at the time I just couldn't seem to get everyone else to see. So the only thing I could do was try and fund it myself. And at that time, I really wasn't making a great salary. But I wanted this business. I wanted this dream so much. And I'm not the kind of person that can handle a boss. So I was like, you need to make some decisions in your life here, Farah. And I was getting a really not so great salary. But I couldn't do it anymore. I couldn't see myself living a life that I didn't choose. Mm. So I decided to make the choices, and therefore I could then be responsible for the choices I made. And I just left. I got my last paycheck, immediately handed in my resignation, paid my bills, and I had R1,000 left. And with that R1,000, I had these little rubbish business cards that were mine, but they weren't the greatest, but they were mine.
They were yours.
And I registered the business, and that's how African Star started. And I mean, I spent pretty much a year working off the floor of my bedroom with a laptop and a cell phone, trying to make ends meet. In the first 3 weeks that I started the business, I had a lucky break. I was actually hired by AIG, who at the time were the sponsors for Man United, who were coming down for one of the soccer tournaments, and they hired me to do a little charity day. I was the only woman-owned company that pitched for it, so to get it was great. And I mean, I made R10,000 off that, and at the time I was only making a R12,000 salary. So you can imagine having your first job and you're like $10,000 in one job,
and then there's a panic to make this thing work.
But no one tells you that, you know. It doesn't all work like that. Yeah, you can get this lucky break and then you're broke for the next year kind of thing. And you spend so much of your time doing free work so you can prove yourself to other people. Yeah. And I'm lucky that people, or I'm very, should I say, very thankful that people believed in me and gave me the opportunity to show them what I was capable of. And now I have a business, and I have these amazing women that work with and for me. And and I love that. I mean, I only hire women. We only use female suppliers. And that's important to me because, especially in my industry, it's very male-dominated. So I'm trying to give women as many opportunities as I can.
As you can.
And it's not always possible, but I do what I'm capable of.
Absolutely. Yeah. You've also come to be known as the Pitbull in Heels. Is there a personal story behind that?
There is a story behind this, and everybody thinks it's a name that I gave myself. No, it's not. I actually had a client, and she had a lot going on at the time, and they did an interview with her, and she said Farah is like a pit bull in heels when she takes care of our clients, and that stuck with me. The media picked it up, and it's never left me since. So people always think that I gave myself this name. No, it was a name that was given to me, and it's never left me.
Well, it's very unique, and I absolutely love it. Now,
Mauritian
has been one of your clients.
Yes.
What was it like working with Farah? Or did you have to be babysat?
Be nice.
Did you have to babysit her?
Wasn't that great, but
yeah,
I'm joking. It was amazing. I mean, very professional. You know, you go in and
you lay, you know, what your plans are and your brand, and they kind of like delve deep into that aspect, because Fera is all about building the brand and what is your brand narrative. And I think it also helps, you can't just be an artist or someone that comes to, you know, to a PR agency just wanting the PR agency to do everything for you. Mm-hmm. I think it's 50-50 because you have to also put in the work and give them content to work with. Mm-hmm. So they awesome.
Yeah.
They amazing.
Yeah.
I'm just saying that because she's the pit bull in heels. I'm joking.
And when it comes to artists in South Africa, I think it's been a slow climb understanding the role of PR in one's career. And also to assemble that team. I mean, words like team and brand and brand narrative are fairly new on the scene.
Yeah. I mean, to us in Africa, the rest of the world, no.
Yeah, definitely they're old hat at it. Yeah.
They completely, and I think they understand it a lot more than we do, but I do think we're getting the hang of what a brand is, what PR is, what a manager is, and people differentiating between a manager and a PR person. And I think that's really important for people to understand as well. So it's great that we are now getting there. I think we've only gotten there in the last 10 years. I mean, if you look at, you know, we specialize as well in music with a lot of our clients. And when I started this, because I'm such a big hip hop head, when I started this, I concentrated predominantly on hip hop artists. Mm-hmm. And I realized that they were amazing, but they weren't out there. They weren't faces of corporate campaigns. Mm-hmm. They want faces of, you know, big events or campaigns. They want faces of anything.
Right.
They were just making money off gigs. And the worst thing you can see, especially in our country, is our artists die broke because we don't invest in them. Mm-hmm. We don't believe in them, and our corporates don't. Well, that was then. Yeah. So now the corporates especially have taken notice of them and realized that our artists are such big influencers and campaigns with our youth, with everything.
Right, right.
So now finally there's remuneration from things like that.
Yeah.
So my purpose at that time when I started was really much to put hip hop in the forefront, especially in terms of corporate, because I was tired of people looking at the genre of music and thinking, it's so thuggish. It's so this, it's so that, and it not understanding that the history behind it, the culture behind it.
Do you find a lot of what you have to do still is educating corporates on how they can engage?
Yes, but not as much. I feel that we're getting somewhere. I feel corporates are understanding, but I also think sometimes corporates, the level of understanding of who is specifically perfect for their campaign is not always understood.
Right.
Sometimes you can be the biggest personality, you know, on the planet, but it doesn't necessarily mean you suit that campaign.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think that's where we are now educating corporates, where it's the best person for your brand rather than just, let's get a famous person in.
I mean, your services are spread across events, management, corporate and celebrities.
Yes.
But how much of your work is just managing celebrity egos?
Can't talk about them now, they're here.
I'll be good.
I think a lot of people, especially in this industry, who do manage artists or just celebrities or personalities, it is hard for them. I think for me...
You're shame. Poor them. I'm teasing.
For me, it's a little bit easier, I think, purely because I am a no-nonsense person. You come into the agency, you tell me what you want, I'm going to do that for you. But don't come in here with your diva tendencies, because I'm already a diva. We can't both be doing this. So, you know, that's not going to work for us. And I think just, you know, having that understanding and respect for each other makes the relationship so much easier. Like, Marishan and I, yes, we had a relationship before she came to the agency, but within the agency, she knows this is what she needs to do. Mm. Whether we're friends or not, this is work.
This is work.
These are the rules. Yeah. This is what you adhere to. You don't like it, it's fine, you can leave. We'll still be friends, but this is my business. So you need to... So I don't think I have as many problems as some other people, but purely just because I have down what I want from you, what you need to get from me, and this is a professional working relationship, and we need to understand that personal feelings don't come into this if we don't, 100%. If we both want to profit from it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, well done. Congratulations on building your empire. But you're not going away. We're going to chat a little bit later. Let's check in with you on social media. Danilo, standing by.
Everyone's loving so much about the fact that you're building a female-only business, Fara. Everyone is sending lots of love about that. They are particularly enjoying the fact that you are working so hard towards those artists who, you know, don't have those egos, the ones that are trying to build their brands from the ground up and have got real pure talent. So thanks for all of those comments that are coming through. But I didn't get a chance to read much of the comments coming through for Mauritian, so I'm going to start with those. Mpuse Mota says, says, wow, she still looks amazingly beautiful. Can't wait for her performance later. You're going to have to stay tuned for that, Mpuse. And Michael Matebe says, she's immensely gifted vocalist with a distinctive vocal style that is rich and full of conviction. And then Lily Montle says, beautiful lady with an amazing voice. I absolutely love her. You guys can keep the comments coming through on our Facebook page. We're Afternoon Express. You can go and find us anywhere and shed as much love as you can for all the guests we have in the loft with us today. And I also know a lot of you are asking about that number for our competition. You're going to have to stay tuned. I hope you've saved it on speed dial on your phones. Three more chances still to win in our Clicks Advent Calendar giveaway. We've got numbers 11, 8, and 14 still left to open today. And you got to wait for that symbol to pop up on screen. The minute it pops up on screen, give us a call and you could be winning yourself a spot prize and getting you the chance to win yourself a Chevy Spark with us on Afternoon Express. When we come back from the ad break, I'm sitting down funny man, Alan Committee. Don't go anywhere. Express yourself. Express yourself. Welcome back to Afternoon Express, live on SABC3. And man, oh man, we're less than a week away from the festive season and that Christmas period. Now, my next guest is one of the best-loved comedians, and now he has a brand-new one-man show as well. Alan Committee's Laughing Matters is currently on show at the Theatre on the Bay in Cape Town. And like I said, with the year that we've had so far, the crazy year that we've had so far, I'm sure he has plenty of new material to draw from. Welcome back to our loft.
It's lovely to be back. It's beautiful. Look at this festive Christmas tree up there. The lovely blue statue, which is very festive. That's a mistake, isn't it? No one knows why that statue's there.
No, it has meaning.
It has meaning.
Yes.
Everything has meaning.
Yes, it's about expressing yourself and just expressing yourself on your facial expressions.
Yeah, this is going very well. I love it.
Exactly. You get it. You've got it.
I've got it.
Fantastic. Listen, this year's been crazy. Everyone has been going mental. People have, like, a lot of famous people have died. We've had crazy world events. We've had floods in Johannesburg. Everything has been going weird in 2016.
And so, in fact, my show is set in a padded cell. Because I reckon, instead of locking up people in an asylum, I feel like in the modern world, in 2016, we're creating our own padded cells and keeping the mad people out.
Oh.
Because you see this, people are building walls between countries, and we're leaving Europe and in South Africa. We don't want foreigners into the country. It's just has been a strange year all round. But as you said earlier, it does feed the comedy. Well, the comedian's materialist, doesn't it?
But you must find the weird fine line between trying to do what everyone else is going to do, talk about the big events of the year, because there's so much material. People are going to think you're a bit like, oh, yeah, cop out, he's spoken about
that again. I think what's interesting is people assume that the comic has now got a lot of material, but in fact it's a harder time because all that stuff is out there on social media, it's out there in the media.
It's funny in itself as well, so...
Well, exactly. Yeah. And in fact, it's very hard to top the reality. The reality is hysterical, so... My aim, I guess, is to try and find a new angle on stuff. Mm-hmm. So, for example, instead of talking about the madness that is Donald Trump, I like to talk about what has led to the potential for voting into Donald Trump. For example, the new shape of the Toblerone chocolate. That, for me, is the kind of mad lack of ethics in society. And if you allow that to happen, then Donald Trump
becomes
president.
It's a slippery slope, exactly. You can't just change the chocolate shape and then expect Donald Trump not to be
elected
as president.
Have you seen the new Toblerone, by the way?
No, I have not.
Now, I bought it, and the Alps are so far apart. I mean, Peter could never find Heidi between those two Alps. Do you know what I'm saying? That's a cry for help.
Listen.
A cry for help. Can we just take a moment? I know it's afternoon, but it's a pleasure.
This man. Listen, let's talk serious things, because I've never actually sat down a comedian and asked very serious questions.
All right, go on.
It's really difficult because I find it hilarious and I just want to have fun. But I want to talk serious matters.
Okay, twice on a Wednesday. I don't even know what the question was.
That was exactly the answer.
Oh,
perfect.
Right.
We can go back to the show now.
Okay.
No, I'm kidding. Let's talk a bit about the nature of comedy. And a lot of people that come to these shows always want to know, you know, like, how do you draw the line between, like, that is just vulgar or that is just, like, disgusting versus that is actually really, really funny, especially with world events that are quite sensitive. Like, imagine if you went up on stage and did a whole comedy skit around Fees Must Fall. I'm sure lots of people would laugh, but it's a very serious matter. So how do you draw the line between inhumane and hilarious?
Well, I think that's a skill set that you develop as you mature as a comedian. I think often as a young comic, and in fact, one of the things I do talk about, I'm celebrating 20 years of doing comedy in South Africa.
Sure, you look less than, younger than 20.
I thank you, sir. If you could just type that out and leave that at the door. But what is interesting is when you start out, you don't always know that. It's about learning what your audience is about, what they expect, understanding your own comic sensibility, and applying those templates to any material.
Yeah.
I do believe, and I think most comics would agree, that almost any subject is open to you. But it depends on what angle you come at it from. So, for example, I do talk about Fees Must Fall, but I don't necessarily talk about the contentious hotbed issue of whether you agree or disagree with the students. I will come in at it from another angle. And that ultimately is, this, I think, the true skill
of a good comedian is to find the attitude or to find the way in which you deliver it. Because sometimes you can say some pretty hard truths with a smile on your face, exactly, and it becomes more palatable.
Yeah. Which is interesting to see, because I mean, I'm a big theatre lover, and I grew up at school talking about theatre, and especially around sort of the theatre that was used to break open stereotypes, right, and to really be a voice and a mirror to society. Comedy is slowly starting to become that. I think it always has been, but in some ways people look to comedy to speak the real truth of what's going on. That's because shows like that Afternoon Express show on SABC, I'm joking, there are a lot of stuff that we're seeing in the media that is sort of filtered through. And
well, it's the old court jester, you know, he used to speak the truth to the king. The most powerful person had a comic next to him who used to filter all the news that he was receiving and try and make him laugh.
Okay.
And that guy's position was very dangerous because he was always skirting, saying exactly what everyone was saying and thinking, but doing it in a way that the king would allow and accept.
Okay.
And I guess that's the role of a comedian, you know. Mm. We all think a lot of stuff. We don't always have the space or the time to speak it or to articulate it. And I think a good comic either does that, or he or she finds a way of saying something that we've never considered. We go, we've always seen that, but never really understood that. It's that simple attitude to it.
I think you're brilliant at that. I mean, I love seeing your performance. You're high energy, you're very witty and very smart kind of humor, which I dig. So give me your thoughts on this crazy phenomenon that started off 2016, where literally Fees Must Fall, I think, had a huge amount of people that were following it. But this thing of Pokemon Go took society and manhood by the kahunas.
Good
and
heavens.
Just took us down some weird path.
Well, it's true. And I think, first of all, no one, for the older generation, you know, for the young folk, we understood, well, I say we, the younger folk understood it. It's a social media related game. People, you suddenly saw people take what was on social media into reality.
Yeah.
Racing around Sea Point or parts of the country, chasing monsters that weren't really there. It was all virtual.
Mm-hmm.
For older folk, we have no idea. I mean, I'm looking, my mom is not great with laptops, for example, or computers. I think, just to divert just for a moment, that's why Hillary Clinton, for example, people say, was she good or not? All I know is, for an elderly lady, she was very good with emails. My gran wasn't good with emails. She's got the old...
Clearly she wasn't good with emails. She doesn't know how to put a protecting code over it.
My gran's got a computer that's so big, we don't have a mouse, we have an aardvark. Do you know what I mean? So the Pokemon Go... I thought Pokemon was a Rastafarian proctologist. So I didn't actually take your moment with that. It's a pleasure.
I'm still trying to get it.
I'm sorry if I'm having more fun than everyone else.
Yeah.
So it is. You're absolutely right. And in this country particularly, we have such a diverse range of cultures and languages and attitudes towards things that when something comes along like this and actually unifies a whole lot of different groups, it can be quite frightening, can't it?
Yeah.
Or at least unexpected. And then, of course, you've got the age group thing, and older folk look at it and go, well, this is ridiculous.
Yeah.
What is this all about?
Yeah. And all the youngsters going like, yes, this is my new life, and
exactly,
it's a new goal and focus.
Chasing stuff on... Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Well, your new show is, I'm sure, going to unpack a lot of those stories of 2016.
Absolutely.
So with this crazy festive season, everyone's nice and busy, this is a really nice way to come and celebrate being young and just have a laugh at the crazy year that we've had so far. Alan Kimmerty, thanks for joining us on the show today.
It's an absolute pleasure.
I can't wait for Southerfingers to check out your show. Over to you, Bonnie.
Who better than Alan Kimmerty to teach Danilo about the difference between hilarious and inhumane? We've loved having a fair fortune, the Pitbull in Heels, in the loft with us today, and we see you have as well. Thank you for all your comments on our Facebook page. Mamelonde says, hashtag love her. Danielle November says, I really admire fair fortune, exclamation. And Diana D. Masarimbani says, she is absolutely hot and a feminist. Lutando says, I love fair fortune. She's one of South Africa's most inspiring businesswomen, forever loving her heart. I love her work. And of course, our Advent calendar has been going full speed ahead. We've got number 11, number 8, and number 14 left. The logo did pop up. We did show it to you. We hope you caught it. We will be chatting to the fastest caller after the break. Don't go away.
We're back in the kitchen now, and Clem, you were showing us about what to do with all those leftovers over the festive season. Really cool hacks that you showed us just now. It's now time for us to actually create something delicious from those leftovers, as well as the one you made us early on.
So I'm scared leaving you next to the stove, so let's swap sides.
Okay.
There we go. I feel a little better now. It's just, you know...
Your feng shui is now back together, and
it really is.
The world is at peace, and we can all just, you know, make delicious food.
Awesome. So, I've got some beautiful, beautiful bright snook. Now, a lot of times during the festive season, especially if you're living along the coast, you get a braai of some type of fish sometime this holiday. But even if you're not, this recipe works so well with chicken and with pulled beef. Pulled beef, all the rage right now.
Yummy.
Love me some pulled beef.
Because everyone had like pulled pork and then like someone was like, oh, what else can I make that's pulled? And then like beef.
Okay, so here's the situation. So you had this awesome braai yesterday, but you forgot to invite that one cousin. Awkward.
Cousin.
He feels awkward, you feel awkward, so you call him over and you invite him over for lunch, but now you actually realize you spent all your money yesterday.
Ooh.
But you got some leftovers.
Ah.
So let's start. Let's start cooking. Right. So we're going to shoot up that beautiful snook that we cooked, we braaied yesterday.
Yes.
And we got to be careful with this. You got to make sure you get all the bones out of there, because if he chokes on this, then he's really going to think it's something personal.
Yeah, so how did you get it like this then? Because I'm guessing you would have like used your hands and individually like sort of like crumbled it out, removed all the bones.
Yeah.
And it's also
we washed
nice.
Our hands. Yeah.
Yeah, you did. And also the point of this is obviously it's going to maybe be in the fridge, which means it'll dry out slightly, which is much easier than to start flaking it.
Dan, so
look
impressed.
At me, man. Look at me.
1 year later. It's been a year since we've actually been in the kitchen together. It's almost our anniversary, Dan.
It's our kitchiversary, kitchenversary.
Yeah.
Loftiversary.
Actually, I'm going to add all of it. There we go. So, mashed potatoes go in there. It's super easy. Mashed potatoes is something, also, you always have like the odd potato lying around the house.
Mm-hmm.
So, just boil that real quick and just mix it in with your snook. Then, I've got some caramelized onions.
These are all your binding agents, I'm sure.
All of it, yes. And the caramelized onions add a nice, savory, sweet flavor to it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to let you get your hands dirty on this one.
Why not?
Nah. Actually, tell you what, just keep on doing this with a spoon while I chop some spring onion.
Okay, cool.
Cool, so spring onion.
That's a simple enough task.
I put spring onion in everything. I love it so much. It's a lot less harsh than like normal onion. But you're probably going to ask, like, why am I using spring onion and caramelized onion?
Well, because I'll tell you, spring onion adds a nice freshness to the really umami taste of the caramelized onion.
Yes!
Yes!
Did you read the script before you came into the kitchen today?
No, what script, Clem?
That's true. We don't do things by script here.
Literally, I don't think you've ever done anything by script in your
no,
life.
No, because a minute ago we were going to make boerewors rolls. I just decided, hey, you know what? Let's make this.
I've got this left over. Let me make something out of it.
Some fresh lemon juice goes in.
Add that zestiness and again that freshness. Because the snook is obviously really fragrant itself, and it's quite a dominant flavor in the dish. So that nice freshness from the spring onions is going to add a nice twist.
Bon likes chili. Do you like chili?
I do love chili. Yes.
Okay, two whole chilies going in. Hope our guests like it hot.
When I say love, I mean like slow down there, tiger. Okay.
There we go.
That's great.
Super easy. So we're using not a lot of ingredients, but you notice the ingredients we are using are quite pungent. A lot of flavor in them. Mm-hmm. So you don't need as many ingredients to like make this one dish. It's quite easy, actually.
Mm-hmm.
So Dan, now,
I'm
here we go.
Invested.
All you're going to do is take a little bit in your hands. Just we go. And shape any type of patty. We're not going to use little ring molds. This is literally just putting it together on your own.
So what you can do basically is obviously make yourself one of the, oh, and you're dipping it in?
Coconut. But look, go on. Yummy. I'll explain.
I was going to say, it's like you can make that into like a little fish cake itself, like a dish on its own, like a little side dish, like a tapas style thing. Or you can make like a fish burger patty out of that.
You
just
absolutely
go buy
can.
Some buns and make a fish burger patty out of your snook, your leftover snook that you've made.
I think so.
Is that
so
a great. Finding agent
so
as well?
Even though we made some breadcrumbs earlier, a great alternative is, and it's a little healthy as well, is to coat them in desiccated coconut.
Yeah, because we have all of that lying out after our dishes, right? Obviously, don't know if you always have, every dish I always have like desiccated coconut lying around, you know?
And what's really great is the desiccated coconut gives it a nice nutty flavor. Yes. I'm ignoring everything you just said.
Cool, and it's sweet enough. It's also got a nice sweet flavor to it, so when you
really
do
cool.
grill it off, I'm sure it'll give that nice flavor.
Yeah, so I'm just gonna pop them into a pan, super easy, and add a little bit of coconut oil in the pan. Okay. And I know that's a leftover because the guys at home actually don't know how many jars of coconut oil we go through on the show.
Probably quite a lot, but Jeannie uses it for
legs.
Yes.
Jeannie uses it.
I've done it once or twice too when you have like really dry hands. Just rub a bit of coconut oil in, okay? And that's simple like that. Those go on a grill and then.
Yes. Super easy. So you let them cook for about a minute aside, you turn them over. And you end up getting these beautiful, beautiful fish cakes that are done in no time at all. We literally made this while we're standing here.
Lovely.
After 2 minutes, beautifully cooked, with a squeeze of lemon, everybody's happy, everybody's eating, and you saved your relationship with your cousin.
Oh, lovely, I like that. All the taste and no waste. Just like that, on Afternoon Express. All the details on how we made our fish cakes are available on our website, afternoonexpress.co.za. There's a recipe there, there's a shopping list there, and all the details on how to put this delicious dish together. And make sure you guys play with it. Enjoy some of your own flavors, throw some things in there, whatever you've got left over. Make it fun, make it simple. Cooking is all about the joy, isn't it? Over to you, Bunny.
We are desperate to have a winner on the show today, and hopefully we have Almarie back on the line. Hello, Almarie.
Hello, yes, I'm here.
I'm so glad you're back. We almost lost you there. So you have three numbers to choose from to win your mystery prize today. It's number 11, number 8, and number 14. Have you made up your mind? Which number are you choosing?
Number 8.
Number 8, sounds good. Mauritian, please come and help me to pop number 8 and find out what she's won. Let's go. Boom. Boom. Okay, here's your prize. You have won yourself a Bulgari gift set product hamper to the value of 4,790 rand. That includes... That includes a male Bulgari fragrance gift and a female Bulgari fragrance gift. I hope you have a bae to share it with. Congratulations. Thank you so much. So you're also automatically entered into the grand prize competition where you stand a chance to win a brand new Chevy Spark. How would winning a car change your life, Almarie?
Oh, it will change our life. We stay on a plot and we've only got one car and we really need a second car.
Oh, absolutely. It sounds like you're in the running to win one, so good luck. Express yourself. Express yourself. Great to have you back with us live on SABC3 Afternoon Express. Now, it's almost the end of the show, but taking us out in style here is Mauritian Letters with a remix of Golo.
Yes.
Take it away.
Thank you.